All right, at this point, the altar's open, and if you wish to come back.
I got one more voice maker than that.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm Sarah, and this is my husband, Justin. I don't know if everyone knows this, but we just recently took over the children's department, and we are so excited. And we just wanted to introduce ourselves for those who that don't know us.
We're going to have a meeting after church right here in the back where the children's ministry takes place. Anybody who wants to help or volunteer, we ask that y'all please show up for just a brief meeting right after church today.
Yes.
And
I love
that
y'all are back there. Our kids are absolutely
loving
it. Thank
you
so much.
And it's for kids 8 through 6. And today, Roland, if you remember, is going to dismiss us.
All right, altar's open. If you wish to come up, doesn't matter who you are, man, woman, child, if you want to stay in the seat and pray, that's fine. I'm going to ask my pastor at home.
Father God, it's an awesome thing to be able to come before you. To know, God, we don't even have to make an appointment, that you're always available. And God, your word teaches us that kind of two or three are gathered and agree together, call upon your name, that you hear. You tell us that the prayer of the righteous accomplish much. And so this morning, Father, we come to you not in our own, not in our own righteousness, but we come to you, Father, covered in your Son, Jesus Christ. We come to you, Father, a people that both know what it is to prosper and know what it is to be needed. We come to you broken, Father. We come to you from that standpoint, God, of once again needing to see your hand at work. The word of needing to learn what it is to depend upon you all over again. Father, this morning in this room, there are people, Lord, that have fear, and that fear is real. And we ask, God, that you wrap your arms around and give them strength this morning. There are some this morning, God, that are battling different diseases and different things, Lord, that they don't let everybody know about, they don't talk about it. And Father, this morning, they're hurting. This morning, God, they're just not feeling well. And God, that you, Lord, would wrap your arms around them, Lord, and just hold them close. And God, love them like only you can. And then, God, there are folks that are here that are battling and having struggles that no one else knows about, Father. Things they don't talk about. Things that they don't even like to think about in their own lives. And, Father, this morning we are thankful that we have the victory, Lord. Not because we're strong, not because we're mighty, but because you're strong, because you are mighty, because you have already won the victory for us. And this morning, Father, we're crying out to you. We're crying out to you because we need you. We need that relationship with you, Father. We need your hand working in all of our hearts and all of our lives, Father. We need you, Father, to build your church. We need you to move in our hearts and our lives, God, that once again we'll be broken for this world that we live in, broken for those who don't know you, Father, who don't have that relationship with you, Lord, and that, God, that we can cry out with all that we are, Lord, that you, Lord, would touch their hearts, and you, Lord, would draw them to that place. And then, Father, not only that, but that you, Lord, would empower each and every one of us to be able to go out and just tell people how awesome you are. Tell people the truth of your word, Father. And, Lord, we pray that everything that we do here, Lord, reflects you, reflects your presence, reflects your love, reflects your body. That, God, that you would be the one who builds your church. You would be the one, God, who does every aspect, provides in every need, Lord, even moving in us that we can join you in what you're doing. Whether it's in the deepest part of Africa or whether it's right next door, Lord, we'll serve you wholeheartedly. So, Father, this morning, we bow before you. And, Lord, your word teaches us that, God, that if your people would call by your name, will humble themselves. And, God, I don't know if we even know what it means to humble ourselves anymore. and that, God, that you will heal my land. And Father, this morning, Lord, I want to pray for President Biden. I want to pray, God, that you move in his life. I want to pray that you give him wisdom, give him discernment. I want to pray for our Vice President Harris, Father. God, that you would move in her heart. And God, I pray that you would move in all the hearts of those who are working in Washington that are supposed to be there to serve the people. And pray, God, that you would, Lord, where there needs to be priority changes, that you would do that. Where there are hearts that need to be changed, that you would do that, Father. And Lord, we can't blame everybody else for our problems. And Lord, truthfully, we've made our share. Because we've not trusted you. We've not leaned upon you. And God, we're turning to you today. And we're saying, God, we need you. We want you, Father. Because we've made a mess, and we're the people that's supposed to know truth. Father, you work in us right now. You open our eyes, you open our ears, and once again, Lord, restore our hearts to that place where we're filled with compassion and brokenness for this world. And then, God, that we're overwhelmed with joy and love for you. Father, we thank you for a day like today. We thank you that, Lord, whether it's COVID, whether it's our government, or whatever the struggle is in our life, that you, Lord, are Lord of all. Amen. This day we praise you, Father, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Many times you've heard your pastor and Brother Jack say, you can't take it with you, but it's what you leave behind. That's the most important. And you know, as I drive home, I get up there to the crossroads and I turn around about 1,000 people across on the side of the road. Then I get in front of Winn-Dixie, there's two crosses in front of Winn-Dixie. And just remember, you need to leave behind because you just don't know how short life is. Okay, bring your wooden crosses. A farmer and a teacher.
Behind you, it's what you leave behind you.
that our preacher told last Sunday, as he held that bloodstained Bible up for all of us to see. He said, bless the farmer and the teacher and the preacher who gave this Bible to my heart, who read it to me.
Amen.
So God is awesome. With that being said, since I heard amen, Matt, how about praying for us right now?
Absolutely. Dear Father, let's pray right now. Just thank you, God, so much for this wonderful day you've given us today. God, just thank you so much for the many blessings that you provide in all our lives this morning, God. Just thank you so much for the willingness and ability to be in your house this morning, God, to hear you through Brother Lynn as he brings your message this morning, God. Just thank you so much for Brother Luther, God, bringing worship, God, and just allowing us to start focusing on you, God, through those powerful words, God. God, just pray as this lesson goes on, that this church service goes on, God, that we can stay attentive and focus on you, God, that not allow outside sources to hinder us from growing closer to you this morning, God. Just, God, just thank you so much for the hearts of Brother Lynn, Mr. Luther, and the deacons, God, and just the heart of every individual in this room, God, and just pray that we can just grow closer to you each and every day, God. God, as we fast this month, God, and continue after this month, God, just pray that we just stay focused on you and realize that all the things that we're putting in front of you, God, does not mean anything, God. And just, again, thank you so much, God, and just pray after we leave the service that we could be joyful and safe as our week continues. Prayer sing in Jesus' name. Amen.
This morning I want to share a word with you. You know, I told you that as we have gone into the new year, one of the things God has been speaking into my heart as we kind of kind of closing out a year after COVID and all that going on in my life, one of the words he's put in my heart was that word prepare. And prepare is not something we think about all the time. Well, maybe it is. Maybe we prepare when we get ready to go on vacation, and we prepare when we're going to do something fun. But otherwise, we don't think of that preparing. We don't think about preparing for everyday life. We don't think about preparing for what's coming. Because in truth, from my viewpoint and what I see and what I hear and what I listen to from Christians around the world, America brothers full brass of Christianity. I mean, we like our cake and we want to eat it too. In other words, what I'm saying is we've had such a we've been blessed. Do y'all realize that? I mean, in the United States of America, even since the very beginning, the times were tough, but they always progressed into greater times and more powerful times. We witnessed times in the 50s and the 60s where numerous souls were coming to Christ left and right, to the point and place where sometimes we get to be a little uppity about who we were and what we were doing. And sometimes I think we forgot that it was Christ who was building the church all the time. And then as time goes on, as numbers fell off, what we began to do, instead of necessarily praying and seeking God's face, like I've heard so many people say, and for many people, we began trying to plan and scheme and formulate opportunities and ways in which we could grow. And really, the way of growth has never changed. The way of growth has always been seeking the face of God and listening to Him and following Him. And so this morning I have a message for you that God really laid on my heart. It's called Pressing Onward and Upward. Because another thing that happens in the church in America, we love to sing the song, God Bless America. And it's so awesome to me that anybody will sing it. Even if they don't know Jesus, they'll sing God Bless America. Even the lost in the world, they want us to be blessed because we like that. We like that place where everything seems to be normal. Isn't that what we call it? Normal. Normal meaning that nothing really changes, nothing gets worse, nothing gets better. We're just in a comfortable place and that's okay. The only problem is I don't see God wanting us just to be comfortable. You know what I mean? I don't see that a great concern in His life. In fact, what I see is concern in His life is the desire for us to grow, so a desire for us to experience that victory that He gives us in life, and the ability to stand when storms come, because storms will come. In fact, I came up with a list of words or concepts that we are not real fond of. One of those is long-suffering. Another might be a word like perseverance or endurance. And we really don't like the word commitment. You know, because we like to leave our options open. You know what I mean? In case something better comes along, I'm not going to commit to this. That way I can do this and not feel bad about it. But you know, God calls us to make commitments. Literally set our feet down and say, we're going to serve the Lord our God. No one else. Nothing else. But, and what about the word conviction? We sometimes use that one as a flip-flop word. We'll tell people, I'm under conviction about this, and what we're actually saying is, I have a preference. Because we really don't know what God said about it. We don't know if God nailed down a fact that I need to have true conviction about or not. It's like conviction. I believe the word of God says everything. You know what I mean? I believe it's absolute truth. Now, that's not my preference. And undoubtedly, it's not a lot of people's conviction this day and age. It's more a preference. I prefer him to be right, but when he's not, I'll cut the nets. And then there, we don't like the concept of consequences or responsibility. And I remember several years back having an argument with a lawyer. I had a young man that had stolen some things, and I wanted him to pay some consequences. They were not dire. I mean, not like I was sitting in jail for 25 years or anything like that. But I needed him to understand that when he did something, there was consequences. And to be able to set those consequences in motion, but also to be able to act once those consequences began to happen, to demonstrate mercy toward him. Well, the lawyer didn't want me to do any of the above. He wanted me to blame his dad or his granddad and the way he was raised. I said, but the only problem is, his dad didn't make the decisions. His granddad didn't make the decisions. He made the decisions. You know, and unless somebody breaks that chain in that life where he understands, regardless of what dad taught me or regardless of what my granddad taught me, that if I don't make right decisions, I'm going to pay a price for what I decide to do, for what I do. You know, and so, but that's a concept that doesn't exist today because we like the concept, well, that's not true for me. Therefore, it's, you know, you can't say anything because this is true for me. And I don't understand that. Well, I do, and Satan's done his job well. And we don't like the concept of justice or being absolute. We don't like authority at all. And we really don't like either one of these words. And the word servant appears in the Bible because nobody likes the word slave, but in truth, we're not going to be a servant or a slave, because we don't like the word submit. And, you know, even in wedding vows today, I have couples that say, we got to take that word submit out. I said, no, I'm notorious for saying that probably we might need to find another pastor. You know, I kind of like that word because it's not a derogatory term at all. In fact, if you understand a relationship, it's not just a wife submitting to the husband, but a husband submitting to the wife. And then having a relationship where they are on equal terms, where they take care of each other, respect and love and adore each other. And so when we don't really understand the word, we're not saying I want you to be my slave master. I want you to be my leader. I want you to be the spirit of head of our home. And so we don't like this term. We don't like surrender. And, you know, the only problem with any of this is they're all biblical concepts, which is why the world says today, the Bible is an antiquated work. It doesn't apply in our lives today. The only problem with that is it is not an antiquated work. It is a work that is absolute truth, and it applies in our life in absolutely every area of life.
Amen.
No exception. Now, there's another word that we do kind of, well, there are some words we like. We like these words. Easy. I mean, things be easy. How about instant? You know, let me test your instant gratification. You show up at Walmart. There are two lanes open. Each lane has 10 people in them. What are you saying? They need to open about 5 more lines. I mean, because we want it now. We want it instantaneous. But have you ever thought that maybe God wanted you to be the 11th person in that line of 10 people because that 10th person needed somebody to talk to? Whoa! I mean, is that a concept? God says, you know, as you go. I mean, just an opportunity. But we like this. We like quick. We like fast. And everybody slowed down today, so it's really messing us up. And in John 10:10, there's a powerful word there. And the word that we like the most, in fact, when I usually ask people about John 10:10, you know what the first thing they tell me is? Jesus came that I might have life and have it to the absolute fullest. And you're right. That's the second half of the verse. Nobody knows what the first half said. And it tells every day because we blame God for all the problems in our life. But the first half says, guess what? There's a thief. And that thief comes to steal from you, to kill you, and to destroy you. In other words, he doesn't like you. His life is miserable, so therefore I want to share your misery. I want you to be miserable with me. He has no love for you. And we have a hard time with that concept. We have a hard time recognizing that. And yet, as I look around every day, I see the hand of the thief at work. Because I see us doubting truth. I see us questioning absolute. I see we're questioning authority. And all of a sudden, we realize that, hey, wait a minute. Instead of growing in our faith relationship with God and growing closer in our relationship with God, what we're doing, we're distancing ourselves from Him. Because we don't, you know, I really don't want to be known as one of those holy rollers. Or somebody that's so religious that I'm no good on earth anymore. I haven't found anybody that made that want to believe yet. You know, most of us are just a problem. We know enough to cause, create problems rather than set free from problems. And for sure, we don't like the Word of God because we're people who basically like to look at each other and say, well, you know, I want to draw the good out in everybody. Is there anybody in here that's ever worked for? You want me to tell you the problem? That's like going to a catfish pond and trying to catch bass. There are no bass in there. It's a catfish pond. So how do you get good out of somebody who has no good in them? And even Jesus Christ made this statement when he was called a good teacher. He says, whoa, wait a minute. There's nothing good about me except the Father. Whoa, let that one step back a minute. So who are we to say that there's good in me? No, the Word of God teaches me that what? All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So every one of us are standing on equal footing at the cross. You do realize that. At the cross right there, we're all guilty of sin. Now what sets us free are those who have a relationship with Christ, who have been forgiven of their sin and recognize that forgiveness and have taken that free gift of salvation, and those who haven't. The difference is not what God does in our life. The gift is what we allow God to do in our life, what we submit ourselves to, and what we surrender to, and what we literally lay hold of. And so all of a sudden you realize that, wait a minute, all have sinned, and they come short of the glory of God. Then you realize there's another problem, And there again, it comes into play with consequences, for the wages of sin is death. In other words, of all the things in the day and age where we talk about what we deserve, well, according to the Word of God, what we all deserve is death. But praise God, hallelujah, what happened? For the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. In other words, it's not something that I do. It's not because I'm living a better life. It's not because I'm doing this versus doing this. It's because I call upon the name of Christ. I have surrendered my all. I have laid it down. I have figured something out. I can't fix me. And I'll go ahead and tell you, I can't fix me. But you know what else? If I can't fix me, you know that my people who are called by my name will humble themselves. And once again, we need humility in the church again. We need that repentance in the church again, where we acknowledge that we have the church, and that we have even changed theology to fit what I want God to be. I want to be healthy all the time. I want to be rich. I want all this other stuff. And so, God, I'm putting you in a box, and I'm demanding you do this work in my life. The only problem is, you look at the Word of God, and you know, it's really strange. Is over this past year, as I have dug a little bit deeper in the Word of God, as I've gone through COVID and some of the other things in life, and I've experienced God's mercy in a very fresh way in my life, you know what I realize? The Bible is more about struggle than it is the victory. Ooh. Have you ever paid attention to that? Moses, Israelites, they're struggling. Adam and Eve, struggle. Their kids, struggle. Job, struggle. Paul, Peter, struggle. Matthew, Mark, Luke, struggle. Jesus, struggle. So the key is not being without struggle, not being without trials or without tribulation. The key is being able to stand in the middle of it. The key is being able to have a victory. One of the first things that people will ask you, and I told you about some of the emails that I got when I first could still read the emails before I went bonkers all the way around. Because there were people asking, do you have the COVID that will kill you? I mean, that's the first thing you want to hear when you're laying in the hospital. The doctor said you're dying. Is that the one that's going to kill you? I'm hoping not. I'm praying not, you know? And then there are those who ask, what did you do to get the COVID? And what they're really saying is, Lamb, what sins in your life that you have confessed? I don't believe you. I was going through the list myself. I was checking every block twice to make sure the Lord had not omitted something. But then I realized something. COVID was about teaching me. COVID was about taking me back to the cross. COVID was about taking me back to that place where that word that he spoke to me night after night. After I finally reached that point in place and said, God, you're right, I'm wrong. And whether I live or die, I am yours. Nothing will change that, and everything will be okay. But it was that place of learning that my strength to do anything in life comes from him. He kept telling me, well, man, I know it's tough. I know. I kept telling him, yeah, Lord, you're right. It's very tough. In fact, I'm very weak. I'm not the Superman I thought I was, God. I need you. And I guarantee you, as you call out, he will be there. You will be able to do all things through Christ who gives you strength. And it's an amazing relationship. And then all of a sudden, you know, you realize that, man, there's a lot of truth in God's Word, more so than I ever realized. And then when Jesus looks in the middle of everything and talks about the sin and talks about our struggle with death and the gift of life, and then Jesus blatantly, openly says, you know, it's not about religion, it's about a relationship with me. In fact, if you look for the definition of eternal life in John 17:3, it literally says this is eternal life, a relationship with the Father through the Son. And that's my paraphrase of it, so go back and look at it. You know, don't trust me. Look at it. Read it for yourself. Allow God to work that spirit of conviction in you. But also understand, this is what he says. Everybody's looking for a way. There are not multiple ways to a relationship with God. There are not multiple ways to an eternal life in the presence of God in heaven. There is one way, and that one way is Jesus Christ. He says, I am the way.
Amen.
I am the truth. I'm the answer.
I'm the life.
You know, that doesn't leave any options, does it? You know, thee is pretty specific. And Jesus is pretty specific. And he says that no man cometh to the Father but by me, Jesus Christ. And so we find ourselves in that place where, you know, Lord, I don't know what to do. I want people to come to know you, so I try to tell them, you know, that everybody's going to be saved, but everybody's not going to be saved. And so we're back to this whole thing again. And so I have some questions for you now. You know, Melinda and I have to go to angels every once in a while. You know what angels is? Mm-hmm. It's, it, on the outside it says antique and...
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll not say anymore. Anyway, I like to go through and I like to wander. It makes me feel guilty. I think of all the things that I threw away that could now make me rich. The only problem is they're worth as much as we have as they were back then, that's it. And what I find is that it's amazing what people will value. I walk up to an item and I say, hey, that's about a 10-10 thing. I'll pick it up and I'll break down again. Whoa! 110? Nope, not for me. Yep, that's not happening. I was telling you, I looked at a pen in there one day. You know, I'm a pretty heavy guy, and I was here because I once was, but I'm still a pretty heavy guy. And there's a bed in there, and it was $1,500. Now, I will admit it was an antique. I will admit it was solid oak. But I will tell you this, that when you put the bed together, it was more rickety than I was the day I came out of the hospital. And I want to tell you, the day I came out of the hospital, if somebody wasn't bracing me or I wasn't holding on that walker, I was going to hit the ground. So I can see me putting that bed together, putting a mattress on it was going to be questionable. And then can you imagine me laying in that bed? Whoa! $1,500 bed just hit the floor! What's it worth to me? I'm mad at that point. I'm breaking that thing up, throwing it out there. It's worth nothing! So the only thing that has value is value what I place on it. And so I want you to look at some things that you might value. So what would you be willing, right here and now, what would you be willing to give for this, for true love? What would you be willing right now to know and to experience true love in your life? What would you be willing to pay? What would you be willing to give right now to experience forgiveness for every wrong you've ever done?
And the weird thing is, your love for those people changes.
Before it was just kind of, oh, well, we'll do our thing together, but, you know, I don't have to stay with you, I go over here. But now all of a sudden you begin to care about them. You begin to care what's going to happen in their life. You begin to care about where they end up. And all of a sudden you begin saying things to them that are not popular anymore. You begin to be concerned about their soul. You begin to pray for them. You begin to share Christ with them. And I'll tell you, there's a price to pay for that. Because not every one of them are going to come to Jesus. Some of them are going to reject you. But I'm saying they're not rejecting you, they're rejecting Christ. But the good news is you planted a seed that one day Christ may empower mightily. And one day they may return to that word. And one day they may cry out because you may have made that difference that day. Because here's the funny thing about God's word. God's word never returns to him void. It accomplishes its purpose. Do we always see victory immediately? No. Sometimes we do. Amen, Ms. Myrtle? There are days, woo, praise God, hallelujah. But there are some days that victory's a little slower. But does that mean that it's not happening? No. We keep our eyes on Jesus. We keep trusting him. Because day by day, moment by moment, what's he doing? Transforming our life. And all those people you say you don't need, I don't need those people at church. Yeah, you do. You need me. You know what else? I need you. We need to encourage each other. We need to build each other up. And now to take you to a word that to me is so, so powerful. Hebrews chapter 12. You know, you have to understand, Hebrews chapter 12 comes in at a tough place. I told him this morning in the early service. That would be like me following Tomlin in his singing. Some of you know who I'm talking about. Or like me coming behind David Crowder. Some of you will know that one. Or maybe coming behind Bill Gaither. Some of you will know that one. And me singing behind him. Can you imagine? I can't carry a 10 to a 10 bucket. Bill Gaither can sing most anything he wants to. Crowder can sing some of the most atomic. You know, all things are wonderful. That's like me. That's kind of like chapter 12, not chapter 11 in the book of Hebrews. Because chapter 11 in the book of Hebrews is the book of faith, the roll call of faith. And you know, read it again. And read it several times today, as a matter of fact. You know what you're going to hear in the middle of this? You're going to hear about people who struggle. You know how they overcame the struggle? They overcame the struggle by faith. There's nobody in here to have a picnic. There's no easy day in here. Nothing described in the chapter 11 is about an easy day. It's all about staying in the middle of the storm. It's all about being anchored in the Word of God. It's all about trusting the Lord in the middle of everything that looks like it's going wrong. It even talks about those who lost their lives in the struggle, what? Of the relationship with Christ. In other words, there were people who killed them because they were Christians. But we sit back and think, where was God? Well, wait a minute. Have you forgotten about the thief? The one who comes to steal, kill, and destroy? Have you thought about the fact that, yeah, they may have lost their life, but in losing their life, they gained life? Oh, they may be listed as martyrs? Oh, but they're now living it like nobody ever lived before, praise God, hallelujah. So as we open up in chapter 12, it's kind of a tough thing to follow, but by the same token, there's some valuable lessons for us right here. Verse 1 of chapter 12. Wherefore, I love that word wherefore because you can replace it with therefore. Or you can look at it and say, well, consequently, or you can say, well, because of chapter 11, because of what went on, because of what took place there, and seeing we also are compassed about. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about. And that's a neat term, the whole idea of compassed about. You know, when you're the quarterback of a football team, you like to be compassed about by your line. You know, because if you're compassed about, their offensive line is notorious. You know, I'm an Auburn fan, but I'll tell you real quick, Alabama's good at that, good at protecting that quarterback. Awesome thing. Now imagine this. Imagine us actually going out into life. And what do we see when we go out there? We see the enemy everywhere we turn, don't we? We see problems everywhere. We're reminded of our failures. We're reminded of all of our shortcomings. And it's like, man, everything's bombarded us. Well, we need to see truth. That we're encompassed about. We're circled. We're populated, enclosed, bound by. With so great, what does it mean? Great in number. You know, that's one of the few times in the Word of God where that great in number means there's a majority of them. There's a vast number of them. The first thing I thought about, somebody's going to say, well, the Word of God says that fewer of those, narrow is the way that leads to life, and broad is the way. Yeah, but let me tell you, it may be narrow and broad, but that narrow part, there's still going to be a big group that goes. Amen, hallelujah. And that big group that's there, that are witnesses, that big group that have stood the faith, I got news for you. They're around you. We stand on their shoulders. They walked ahead of us. They walked behind us. We were encompassed about. You know, and here's the problem with that. We don't like that because why? It means I have to think about the way we live. Because if I start thinking about those who paid the price before me, I have to look and say, oh my goodness, I'm a whiner. Man, I want to be a winner, but I find myself a whiner because here are all these people that struggle. Here are those people that the church in China right now. I mean, it amazes me that the church in China is the thriving church in the world right now. And then the most persecuted church in the world. You know, we keep praying. You know, I tell you what, you know, we may be praying for the Chinese to quit praying the way they pray, because I'll go ahead and tell you, the church in China, the church in Korea, in fact, the church in Asia, you know what they pray for the United States? They pray for it to come under persecution. Because they've seen what persecution has done in their land. Persecution in their land is called the church of prosperity. The church is in the prosperity of the truth about souls, and souls are coming left and right. There are people that are going to prison, that are watching their children be killed, that are spending 15 and 20 years in prison for their belief, and only for their belief. And they're being put in prison, and they're during that prison. In fact, when they're in prison, what they're doing, they're discipling other prisoners. And if you want to know how bad it is, you can't go into any one of those countries and proclaim yourself a missionary, because they will send you packing if they don't send you to prison first. And here we are, blind as an election. Oh no, I may have to pay more taxes. How many of you are going to jail tomorrow? Y'all are okay, I don't see any police out there. I don't even see the National Guard out there. Y'all okay? Anyway, here's the weird thing. How many of you, when you leave here, are going to tell somebody about Jesus? Yeah, it's not the same guy in Korea now. He's being put in prison. Oh man, yeah, I'm going to open mission field now. Let's go to start having a Bible study in prison. I mean, I can hear them in there. They say that we never thought about singing. You know, sometimes the Lutherans up here, or jails up here, they have to say, oh, come on now, let's sing. Yeah, can you imagine going into a prison? And man, I'd be embarrassed. I'd be so encompassed about my people who are so in love with God that have paid a price for that relationship with God because they cherish it. They value that relationship. In other words, they would give anything they could give for that relationship. And they wouldn't give anything other than their life. But in giving their life, they're gaining their lives. Because salvation is a free gift. Oh, it's not free, is it? He paid the price for it. For you and me. See, so how much do we really want that? So we have this crowd of great witnesses around us. And then he says, well, let us lay aside. And to lay aside means literally just that. I was using my army buddies as an example while ago. You know, I see all those days when y'all are jumping out of planes. You know, I stood there and watched the guys that jumped. And man, they jumped, they got to push me out.
Every burden
every weight that does what? Encumbers us. I'm going to pick on my buddy here. Roger, I could pick on several of you, but I choose Roger. He's right here in front of me. If you're loaded down, like you're going to jump out of that plane, you got your big pack on, you got your parachute on, you got your weapon hand somewhere, you got everything on the sun. I don't know how much you weigh by then, but you're overweight, I'm sure, by then. And somebody says, there's a bear coming! What do you do? You either lay there or you start stripping fast. I got news for you. You may do nothing, buddy. I'm going to be cutting cord. I don't know about my life, but I'm going to be cutting straps, cord, everything else. Shoes if I have to, because I'm going to leave Roger sitting there while this boy is running. That way I know who the bear is not going to do. Anyway, I've been sitting there waiting on you. I don't know, but to say, you know, and literally, you know, sadly, what we do in life, we get so encumbered and so weighed by down by life itself that when God says, I need you to do this, we say, I can't, God, because I'm busy. When the enemy shows up to steal, kill, and destroy, we can't even fight him. And we're so weighed down with the world. We're so in love with the world. We're so... We're not upset about that things are not normal. We're not upset about the fact that he's stealing from us. We're not upset about the fact that our joy has disappeared. We're not upset about the fact that we're losing the battle for souls in this world. We're seeing the kingdom of God not growing and prospering like it should. We're not being fruitful as we should. We're struggling. So he says, lay aside every burden, every weight. Oh, and then it really gets to the point. This is the part of it where we really don't like it. Because then he says, and the sin. Sin. And nobody needs me to describe sin. You don't need me to define it for you. You don't need to tell you about missing the mark. Because every one of us knows sin. You know what the really sad thing is? The majority of us are sitting here right now with a boatload of sin that we know is going on in our life. And we have no intentions of ever repenting. We have no intention of ever turning away from that sin and turning back to God. We just say, God, you just have to put up with me. I'm a Christian, but I'm a sinner. Does that work? Is that true? It may be truth as far as the picture. It is not truth about where God wants us to live. Because he's told us that what? If we'll confess our sins, he'll be faithful and just to do what? Forgive us our sins. He told us he'll cleanse us, he'll wash us, and throw away our sins as far as the east is from the west. So he's letting us know, no, you don't have to sit there every day and say, I am just a sinner. All you have to do is keep your eyes on me, trust me, and be open with me, and be righteous with me. In other words, let him know what's going on. He already knows anyway. Agree with him, confess, repent, turn to him, and turn away. And guess what he does? Breaks the chain. We love that song so much. We'll sing it with such vigor. Oh, we'll sing Amazing Grace and we'll sing Adam and you tack on this there. And he breaks the chain that sets us free. We'll celebrate that. But has he really done that in your life? Or is it just a song that sounds good? Gets your emotions stirred a little bit, but you really never unpack the suitcase. You know, most of us come to church like this. We look worse than Roger. We don't have the backpack on. We got the backpack on, but we pulled a wagon behind us. In fact, all we ended up doing was strapping that to our belt in the back, and we got a wheelbarrow in front of us. Because we got all the stuff we plan on keeping with us. And so when God says move, well, God, just give me time, I'll get there. We're so encumbered. I don't have time to share Jesus with anybody because I'm so busy with the stuff that I love in life. What happened to love in life? What happened to loving Jesus? What happened to loving our neighbor? And wanting him to know the freedom and them to know the freedom that you and I do actually have in Christ Jesus. So he says, lay aside the sin that it does what? Which doth so easily beset us. Y'all like that word beset in King James, don't you? You have no idea what it means, do you? It's that weight. It's that wagon I'm pulling, that load I'm carrying, that wheelbarrow I'm pushing. Yeah, it keeps me from running the race and running in such a way as to win. That means I'm just barely moving. You know, think about it. Most of our Christian life is sad, but one of the reasons we don't like to journal is because we never have anything to say. And the reason we never have anything to say is because we don't dive into the Word enough to hear God speak about what He wants to do in our life. And even when He does speak, we say, oh, God, that's not really what I was looking for. So it's kind of like, how many of you play some of those games on Facebook occasionally? That, you know, you push, what kind of dog will you be? Or, you know, what we, yeah. Have you figured out you can push that button as often as you want until it gives you the one you like, and then you can put that one on the internet? You know, the first one had two legs, it was a sharp baby, I can see that. But that's kind of not where we all fall. How many of you know the name Hernán Cortés? Hernán Cortés, well, he outdates a few of you. Marcy, you may be like 1700s. Anyway, he was an explorer, an adventurer. He was really a gold digger, basically. You know, he didn't get the permission of the king of Spain. He wanted to do some exploration. He wanted to come to the Americas. He wanted to go to Mexico, as a matter of fact. Them or burn them. And what has been understood was, there's no going back. We'll do nothing but press forward toward the goal. And you know, it is sad when a man will do that to receive a prize that is only temporary. We've got a prize ahead of us that is eternal, that is forever, affects everybody's life around us forever and eternally. And I want to tell you, it's time, ladies and gentlemen, we burn the ships for the right reasons. It's time we set ourselves ahead and our eyes ahead, and we quit looking at what's behind us. And we press on toward the goal. Press onward and upward. People say, well, pastors, you don't understand. No, I do. It's a problem. I spend enough time where you are now. I know the struggle. I know the heartache. It's not territory that I don't have been. That we go back to occasionally. But do we even expect to see the supernatural work of God? Do we expect to see souls saved? Do we expect to see lives turned around? Do we accept it? Do we expect to see the captives set free? Do we expect to see those who are struggling gain victory? There's a church right now. I won't tell you the name of the pastor. I'll tell you the church is in Tennessee. And I'll tell you, this happens to be a fairly large church. But it's a church that went back to doing things God's way. They began to build relationships. They began to build everything around disciple and disciple making. So that even during the pandemic, when the doors had to be shut, the church did not cease being the church. It continued to grow. It continued to minister. It continued to love. The smaller groups continued to meet. And right now, the last two services, unplanned, became nothing but baptismal services. Where not only did they have the ones that they knew they were going to be baptized, but as they were baptizing, they had people that were coming up and confessing their sins and saying that it was time for them to burn the ships behind them. And the only way anybody can explain it, it's not an emotional drive. They don't have the pepper-like team up there egging them on. It can be explained by no other means than God moving. Nothing spectacular other than the presence of God. And so I looked this morning. And yet, there is a price. It means life doesn't stay the way it is. But from where I'm standing, been there, I'm glad my life didn't stay the way it was. If my life had stayed the way it was, I'd probably be in jail right now. Or better yet, I'd probably be dead right now. Because I can remember a time that even as a Christian, I thought I would 9 feet tall, 4,000 pounds. I didn't think there was a soul out of it that could whip my backside. Never had to get in a fight because most people were intimidated by the fact that I thought they were. I can remember walking up and stopping fights. I was foolish. The only strength that I have comes from God. And that's the only strength that matters. So I ask you, the route to everything you're looking for, the route to even living a life that is filling, fulfilling, can be found only in Jesus Christ. I'm sorry. So my question is this.